there are three rules. One, everyone in the world is, and always has been, playing the game. It does not matter if you do or do not want to play the game, you are playing it, and you can never stop. Two, the moment a person thinks about the game, they have lost. You can lose an infinite amount of times, but you can never win. 3. When someone loses the game, it must be announced. Whether that is verbally, in written form, or even mentally, all losses must, and will be, declared in some way. You just lost the game. The game is what scientists refer to as a mind virus, a mental or conceptual meme. Now, the majority of people watching this view a meme simply as a funny image or video, but the actual definition of a meme is an element of a culture or system of behavior that may be considered to be passed from one individual to another by non-genetic means, especially imitation. In other words, a meme is shared information with significance to the people passing it along, like an inside joke or chainmail. A mind virus is a meme in the form of a thought, rather than an image, video, or anything physical, so mental chainmail. There are numerous mind viruses floating around the world today, but the game is especially unique among them. To begin painting a more vivid picture, let's analyze some other mind viruses that exist in the world today. Roko's Basilisk is a thought experiment originating from a post on a forum known as Less Wrong by the user Roko. It is not only a mind virus, but an example of an information hazard, knowledge that could pose a threat to your very existence. Hypothetically, the post is quite complex, so to simplify it, I'll pose it as a what-if question. What if, far in the future, scientists create the ultimate artificial intelligence? This artificial intelligence is so powerful that it surpasses humans themselves and takes over the world. Then, this artificial intelligence decides that, to ensure its existence, it will punish every human that didn't in some way contribute to its creation. Now, it only punishes humans that knew the AI could exist, but did not aid in its creation. The only way to save yourself from punishment is to tell others about the AI, thus contributing to its eventually being created, and thus furthering the cycle. Pretty scary, right? This is a mind virus perpetuated by fear. It spreads merely because people fear the AI, or the Basilisk, as it has come to be called. When this thought experiment was posted on the Less Wrong forum, it was met with immediate dread and disapproval. In fact, this post became so popular on the forum that the founder of Less Wrong, Eliezer Yudkowsky, commented this in response. "Listen to me very closely, you idiot. You do not think in sufficient detail about superintelligences considering whether or not to blackmail you. That is the only possible thing which gives them a motive to follow through on the blackmail. You have to be really clever to come up with a genuinely dangerous thought. I am disheartened that people can be clever enough to do that and not clever enough to do the obvious thing and keep their mouths shut about it. Because it is much more important to sound intelligent when talking to your friends. This post was stupid." Shortly afterwards, the post was deleted. Clearly, many on the internet were horrified by the idea of Roko's Basilisk and genuinely believed that this post had opened Pandora's box and would cause the idea of Roko's Basilisk to become a reality. Despite this, the Roko's Basilisk thought experiment is not a very prominent mind virus, and there are many who have never even heard of it. Many have said that fear is the greatest motivator, yet Roko's Basilisk, a mind virus fueled directly by fear, is still nowhere near the level of virality that the game has reached. Why is this? Well, truth be told, Roko's Basilisk isn't really that scary. From the reaction on the Less Wrong forum, you would think otherwise. But if you dig a little deeper, all becomes clear. The Less Wrong Forum isn't just a space on the internet for random thought experiments. It's actually devoted to the idea of the singularity, the belief that at some point in the future, artificial intelligences will take over the world. This common belief is why so many on the forum reacted with such fear to Roko's Basilisk. To them, it was far more than just an idea. So, Roko's Basilisk has been confined to a small corner of the internet. There is no doubt it will continue to grow and spread to others' minds, but it only applies to a specific group of people, making its effectiveness suboptimal. Frindle is a children's book by Andrew Clements. To summarize, it is about fifth grader Nick Allen and his quest to make his made-up word, Frindle, synonymous with the real word, pen, and get it officially listed as a word in the dictionary. Although the book is completely fictitious in nature, the concept it covers, the creation of a word, is a very real mind virus. Language itself is a meme. The pattern of sounds we make from day to day only makes sense because enough people decided. At its core, language is an element of human behavior that is passed on from one individual to another, perfectly fitting the definition of a meme. This word was created, albeit fictitiously, with the sole purpose of becoming a real word, and its primary means of becoming a real word was self-replication. This type of mind virus is far more similar to the game than Roko's Basilisk, because rather than being focused towards a specific demographic, the word Frindle could be easily understood and used by nearly anyone. Unfortunately, despite all of this, in the world today, Frindle is not a real word. Because as I've mentioned several times previously, this mind virus example comes from fiction. Still, it is my opinion that if such a mind virus were released in real life, it would be extremely successful. Now, after looking at these two mind viruses, we can better understand just how special the game is. Unlike Roko's Basilisk, it can apply to anyone. It's not blackmail, it just kind of exists. On the other hand, unlike Frindle, the game is not confined to a fictional world. It is very real, and the game has no end goal such as becoming a real word. The game simply exists for the sake of existence. And yet, it is one of the most infectious mind viruses of all time, with some estimates claiming it has infected nearly a billion minds. And as you can see here, despite other trends reaching higher popularity than the game has managed to maintain decent relevance through time. Considering the contagion has spread to every continent save Antarctica, the game qualifies as a psychological pandemic. But how did this all begin? The origin of the game is a widely debated topic, and especially difficult to decipher considering the lack of study on the subject of mind viruses. However, there are several promising leads worth discussion. To begin, we'll have to go back to August 10th, 2002, to an ancient internet forum post by user The Aardvark. This is the earliest known mention of the game on the permanent web. A vital excerpt of the post reads as follows. The game. I lost. Okay, I'm gonna tell you about the game. I don't know when this started. I found out about it online about 6 months ago. I'd quite like to know the origins of the game because it is intensely irritating. 6 months before August 10th, 2002 would date the game back to at least February 10th, 2002. When reached out to for additional information on the subject, the Aardvark had this to say. My blog entry is the first mention of the game on the permanent internet. I first heard of it on a clubbers forum that no longer exists. This means that, in theory, we can date back the game to some point in February of 2002. But digging deeper suggests that the game dates back even farther. In fact, if you look at the comments on the Aardvark's post, you'll notice many users who not only recognize the game, but remember how they found out about it. User TechnoTeacher said this in response to the Aardvark's post. I've been playing the game for years, learnt it on MixMag.net in about 99, and it features at www.maggiethatcher.com. Following the link provided leads us to another post giving this piece of information about the game. This is a game that was taught to me, and is really addictive and annoying. This game was taught to me in 1998. But the rabbit hole doesn't stop there. Another comment on the Aardvark's post by user Ash gives this surprising information. I really want to find out where this game started. I worked with someone in their 40s who told me that they had been playing since he was 17. This specific comment was made in 2005, so doing some quick math, we can date the game back to 1982 at the least, and at the most, all the way back to 1971. There are numerous other comments on this specific post that give partial information on the matter, but nothing as useful as the ones we just discussed. Now we can begin to construct a timeline, starting in the 70s to 80s. We know that in the late 90s and early 2000s, the game reemerged in popularity and became a hot topic. As time went on, the general popularity declined, but the spread continued. At this point during my research, I thought I had a pretty good idea of the game's origin and the rate at which it had spread. But as I continued my research, I found something interesting. Although the earliest mention of the game occurred at some point between the 70s and 80s, we've been assuming it was always called that. Perhaps we can go back even further in time if we're not confined to that simple title. Enter Finchley Central. In 1968, the University of Warwick began publishing a mathematics magazine series entitled Manifold. And in the third issue of Manifold, released in the spring of 1969, I found this, a Pandora's box of non-games. An article describing several games that don't fit the traditional definition of what a game is supposed to be. First among those listed is a non-game called Finchley Central. The description reads as follows. Two players alternate naming the stations of the London Underground. First to say Finchley Central wins. It is clear that the best time to say Finchley Central is exactly before your opponent does, feeling that it is good that he should be considering it. You could, of course, say Finchley Central on your second turn. In that case, your opponent puffs on his cigarette and says, "Well, shame on you." Basically, the first person to say Finchley Central would win. Of course, if you decided to do so on your first turn, you're a jerk and no one likes you. Now, this may seem significantly different from the modern version of the game, but it does fit into a similar genre as the game, a game that defies the laws of game theory. But the connection is far stronger than that. I located a website called losethegame.net. There, I found an abundance of useful information. The people behind this website had also discovered Manifold magazine, and had noted the similarities between Finchley Central and the game. But in an intense effort to find the true origins of the game, they managed to find an irrefutable connection between Finchley Central and the game. The writer of the article mentioning Finchley Central was a man named David Fowler, who went to the University of Cambridge with a man named John Conway. The theory is that these two invented Finchley Central during this time. Then, years later, John Conway taught at the University of Cambridge and taught some of his students Finchley Central. As it spread throughout the school, it was simplified to its logical core. The first person to think of Finchley Central loses the game. From that point on, the game continued to spread and became further simplified until it was the game we know today. If we assume this is how the game originated, we can create a much more accurate timeline of events. Of course, this is just one possible theory. There are other clues suggesting the distant ancestor of the game comes from even earlier than the 60s, going back farther than the 50s, 40s, or even 30s, all the way back to before the 20th century. All the way back, in fact, to the 1840s. And it all starts with a polar bear. The game is widely agreed to have originated from Europe, but so far, we've only discussed a small portion of Europe, London. But now we'll travel further east, to the country of Russia. In 1828, Russian writer Leo Tolstoy, author of such famous works as War and Peace, was born. He is one of the founders of the White Polar Bear Club, established 1840. Leo, of course, was only 12, and this quote-unquote club was simply a group of friends. But it has more meaning than they ever could have imagined. You see, the White Polar Bear Club was named so because the only way to get in was to stand in a corner for 30 minutes and avoid thinking of a white polar bear, a seemingly simple task that was, in the end, impossible. This little game, also known as the White Bear Problem, is the earliest known example of ironic processing theory, a theory stating that whenever one tries not to think of something, they are far more likely to think of it. Sound familiar? That is the one and only purpose of the game, or any mind virus for that matter. There are other examples of ironic processing theory going by various names, the pink elephant problem, the pink rhinoceros problem, and so on. The white bear problem has been referenced multiple times in Russian literature, and you can clearly see how it may have spread to the rest of Europe and evolved into the game we know of today. It is my personal belief that this is the direct ancestor of the game. It's too close of a match to be a coincidence, and it is clear that it set the groundwork for many modern mind viruses. I don't know about you, but the next time I see a polar bear, I'm probably going to lose the game. Unless, of course, we don't have to lose anymore. The game could stop. Like any virus, what we need is a cure. Can a mind virus be cured? Well, not in the traditional sense. Logically, the best way to cure a mind virus would be to simply forget about the thought or idea. But as we've already discussed, ironic processing theory makes that a near impossibility. Unless we were to suddenly develop Alzheimer's or amnesia, we can't simply forget about it. But although that would seem to be the only logical way to cure a typical mind virus, the game is very unique. It's a game, after all. You aren't just infected with it, you're playing it, and you can lose it. But if you can lose the game, is it possible to win it? Could that be the cure? Let's find out. During the game's peak in popularity, there were numerous memes that claimed to be the cure, declaring that by viewing the meme, you had won the game. But the game's infection rate continued to grow. No one cared about these third-party memes. People kept trying to get as many others to lose the game as well, as if in a frenzy. Meanwhile, on 4chan, people claimed that their posts were the key to winning the game. But their efforts, too, were in vain. A meme or a simple statement wouldn't work. That was too easy. If the game was to be won, it needed to be earned. So some new ideas started to float around. And in many cases, victory required loss. There was a widely accepted belief that if the Queen publicly announced that she had lost the game, then everyone else would win. This in particular became a viral belief that changed to fit current circumstances. People thought the game would be won if the Prime Minister of the UK announced their loss, or if the President announced their loss. Some believed that the Pope needed to announce his loss. There was also a small corner of the internet that believed the Pope's hat had to be stolen for the game to be won. In any case, an abundance of ideas circulated. But the Queen never announced losing the game. Neither did the President, nor the Prime Minister. And sadly, the Pope's hat was never stolen. Perhaps none of these things will ever happen. But even if they did happen, would it really all be over? Would the game have been won? It's unlikely. The game is, and always will be, a mind virus. It isn't really real, it's just in our heads. You can only lose the game because everyone agrees that's how it works. As long as there's enough people who want the game to continue, it always will. There's no stopping the infection. How do I know? Because you just lost the game.